I've given you the outline of the course, which is the shown here. We will have first the introduction to aeroelasticity. That is, what is aeroelasticity? To learn that, we will come to that. But here, we need to have some background in the aircraft structures. So that part I will cover in the after introducing to what is aeroelasticity, and then what are the various types of problems, aeroelastic problems we encounter, and that is again in detail. We have static aeroelasticity, and then we have the dynamic aeroelasticity, but in between we need to have again aerodynamics, which is a unsteady aerodynamics. So I will cover some part of the unsteady aerodynamics, and last is panel flutter, which is again an aeroelastic problem. I will give a brief introduction. So this is how the course is arranged. So you have the course outline. Now we will see what is aeroelasticity, because we have it is essentially a study of the interaction of aerodynamics, inertia and elastic. These three, the interaction of these three, how they affect the aircraft structure, and then the last is how they influence the design itself. That is very important. Suppose if the aircraft is rigid, or any of our flying vehicle is rigid, then this field is not existing at all. There is no aeroelasticity. But we have highly flexible or deformable structure. That is why aeroelastic problem becomes very important. Now this particular interaction is described by something called a collar diagram or triangle, okay, or collar triangle. You can take this is aerodynamics, inertia and elastic, okay. Aerodynamics and elastic without inertia, this particular interaction is called static aeroelasticity. That is this part, okay. If you take elastic and inertia, this is basically your mechanical vibration, okay. So you can say this is mechanical vibration or structural dynamics, anything you can call it, mechanical vibration or structural dynamics. Aerodynamics and inertia, that is basically your flight mechanics, because there you do not consider the aircraft as a flexible body, you treat it as a rigid body. Therefore, all the dynamic problems, basically your flight mechanics problems, are the interaction of this. So I will put it as essentially flight mechanics, okay. But you don't treat the, sometimes they call it dynamic stability, rigid body dynamics. You may call it, even if you want to call it, This is rigid body dynamics. Okay. So this is here. Now the interaction of all the three is the dynamic aeroelasticity. Okay. All right. Now you see our entire aeroelastic analysis as a subject requires input from inertia, input from structures, input from aerodynamics. That means you should have background in all these things. That's why first you study structures course, you study aerodynamics course, you study vibrations course, and then you come to aeroelasticity course. Okay? You can't start with aeroelasticity right at the beginning. All right. Now this is the very basic level. Now to this you have now hypersonic flow, which is a high temperature effects are coming. If you want to include thermal effects, then the same subject becomes aerothermoelasticity. Okay, these are all offshoot. Aerothermoelasticity. That is the effects of temperature on the structure and also your flow, everything. And that is this subject. Similarly, you can introduce control theory into the, because you can have active flutter and various types of things are there related to aeroelastic problems. That means you are bringing in control theory into that. That is called aeroservoelasticity. Okay. Now you see how the field is changing, expanding to include various aspects of either thermal, but if you want to include servo, you must know the control theory. Okay. And this is how the topic really develops. Now if you look at, I will briefly write, what are the very specific problems or issues associated with static aeroelasticity and dynamic aeroelasticity. Very specific problems. And actually this entire course deals with only those problems. Okay. So I erase this. Static aeroelasticity. Under this, we have one of the very important problems called divergence. Okay. But then you may ask, divergence of what? Divergence of lifting surfaces, you may take it divergence of wing. Okay, aeroelastic problems are always associated with the lifting surfaces. Please understand. Okay. But you may say, what about fuselage? Do you treat the aeroelastic? If it is a panel, if it gets into supersonic something, then panel vibration, which may be a aeroelastic problem. Otherwise, divergence. Next one is control effectiveness. Okay. Or control reversal. Okay. This is essentially when you say control, with what you control the aircraft. You use the ailerons or elevators, any of those. So they are, but normally they put control reversal, they sometimes use aileron also, okay? aileron reversal, okay, or aileron effectiveness, something like that. And another one is load redistribution. You may say load distribution on wing, okay. Due to deformation, that is the key, due to elastic deformation. That's all. These are the problem. What I will do is I will first write a list out what are the key aspects. After that I will show a few of the history about this whole subject, and then that time you will see, okay, what these things mean. The next, under dynamic aeroelasticity, we have first is flutter, we call it. Okay. Then you call another one which is called buffeting. Okay. And third, you call it due to dynamic response due to gust loads or landing, any impact load. Okay. Suddenly applied load, how the wing changes. That can be due to a gust. So this I will put it as dynamic response. Okay. Either due to gust or landing. Okay. Now these are your major topics, that's all. Now you have this. You may be wondering, okay, we all know these problems. So in aircraft design, how they influence the design, because that is the key. One, you have to know these problems, and the next one is you make sure that they don't affect your performance of the aircraft. Today you will say whether there are approaches, whether we can tailor our properties or the wing by suitable design, can we take advantage of these, some of these problems, which we call it as a problem, whether we can take advantage of that. Okay. That is how this study is very, very important, particularly when the aircraft becomes more and more flexible. Okay. They assume a very, very prominent role. Now, I thought I will give you a brief historical background. How this started, whether Wright brothers really knew about this problem. Okay, is a question. See, in the beginning, Wright brothers, you all know, was successful. That is the first flight which has happened. But before him, there was another person who flew the aircraft, but his name is Samuel C. Langley. Okay. He flew the aircraft on a small scale that I will show in the next, okay, these are the books, we will come to the books later. This is the aircraft model which was developed by Langley, okay, it is a monoplane. Monoplane means only one wing. Whereas the biplane, you will have like this. Okay. Monoplane, all today's aircraft, they have only monoplane. So this is biplane, right? And this is monoplane. He made this, and this is a quarter size model which he flew. That was in 1896. He flew it. It was successful. And you see the propellers are here. But then he got a grant. He was actually the director of Smithsonian Institute. Then he got a grant to build a manned vehicle. Manned vehicle, he built it. And he, see, it was a catapult. It is a, they call it a houseboat. On the top of it, this is mounted, and a pilot will be sitting. They will just pull it and then leave. And what happened was, this is a full scale, in the sense manned flight. This is before Wright brothers flew in 1903. One was October 7th and another was December 8th. Just few, I think, December 17th was Wright brothers flight. This was December 8th. But this, as soon as he took off, it just fell into the water. Okay. It was not successful. Now this is a wing twist failure, October-December 1903. Had he been successful, he may be in the history. Of course, he is in the history today, but like Wright brothers, he would have been in the history of aviation. But he was building monoplane. Why Wright brothers were successful? His flight failed. Okay. This initially, there was some question, why this failed? That is because Wright brothers made a biplane which was torsionally stiff. Okay. So they were successful. That's why in the beginning of aviation, the failure of this, the success of this, led to design all the preliminary aircrafts which were built in the beginning were all biplane. Okay, I'll show someone. This is taken from the book Whispering of Ashley Hoff. Now this is all old. Now what is the problem which aeroelastic problem the biplanes normally faced was the tail oscillation. The fuselage tail combination, they will oscillate. So you basically increase the torsional stiffness. But later, even during World War I, in Europe, they were building the monoplane. Monoplane means this is a monoplane. And this particular thing, it's the Fokker D8. Okay. It was supposed to be a high performance aircraft to be delivered to the army. It was delivered. But whenever the wing, the aircraft goes into a dive, the wing will fail. Okay. Now, it's a very interesting history. The users blame the designers. But designers say there is something, because nobody knew what was the problem. But when army tested the wing, because it is designed for 6 times the load of the aircraft, 6G. They put that 6G load, wing is fine, it's not breaking. Then it became a problem, what is that really happening? Okay. Then it came back to the company, and when they tested it, suddenly the I think Anthony Parker, it came to him. He was the, that is why the Parker company is there. What was observed was when the wing was deforming, suddenly he found that the twist was happening. There is a torsional deformation, which means my angle of attack is changing. That means my load is changing. Okay. So this was the first observed phenomena that, hey, this is what wing divergence. That only led them to think that, okay, I have to take care of some problem which is due to the elastic deformation. Okay. And subsequently, of course, during the 1920s, 30s, mainly racing. So they put high performance, powerful engine, more faster, etc., etc. Okay. Only after it was understood in the 1930s onwards, only the monoplanes, successful monoplanes were coming, 1930s, around that. Now, the problem with the monoplanes, you start having, again, now I have listed out, all these problems are there in all, because today you find everything is a monoplane. So you have to analyze all these problems related to, because they are all cantilever wings. So they go through this, wing divergence is one problem, then you have a flutter problem. This is static aeroelastic problem, another one is the dynamic aeroelastic problem. You need to take care of both these problems. Okay. Now I will show, in the static problem itself, there is a, due to deformation, the wing load gets redistributed. So you see, this is a very recent, I think 2000 or something like that. This is a high altitude, long endurance aircraft with the solar panels, everything. You see the kind of deformation the aircraft is having. It is just to show you that how flexible the wing for this particular model. This left diagram shows, this is for a swept wing aircraft. See, the continuous line and the dashed line. The dashed line represents the rigid wing. Suppose you treat the wing as rigid, then you directly put the wind tunnel test, aerodynamic load, you can get the distribution. But if the wing is deforming, because of the deformation, the load is now gets redistributed. Okay. So they say the center of pressure moves inboard and things like that. But because of the redistribution, your structure has to be modified, because the loading, bending moment, shear force, torsional moment, everything will change. So the redistribution plays an important role. And another one is that control effectiveness, or another one, this is called the aileron reversal. Or what happens is, if the wing is rigid and you deflect the aileron, what are we doing? When you deflect the aileron, you are essentially changing the camber. Okay. When you change the camber, you increase your lift, but at the same time you also change your pitching moment. Okay. Pitching moment, if it nose down, what happens? It's going to reduce the angle of attack of the wing. Right? Now I increase my lift by deflecting this, but the moment is trying to reduce my angle of attack, which will reduce my lift. So the combined effect of this, initial speeds, it is fine. That's why this is a Mach number that is shown. Here it is essentially written as rolling velocity by aileron angle deflection. That means as the Mach number increases, it's fine. But beyond some point, it starts rolling velocity by deflection, this, that start decreasing, which means it may hit a point where it is zero. That means it is ineffective. At that speed, whatever you do, nothing will happen. Beyond that speed, what you do will do the opposite. That is, if you want to turn left, actually the aircraft would turn right. Okay, this is the control reversal. So control reversal speed is one. Control effectiveness is this. If it is a rigid aircraft, you will get one. If it is a flexible aircraft, you will get something else. So these things have to be analyzed. And then this is for the elevator. See, the elevator problem is more complicated because the wing, the fuselage itself can bend. The fuselage deformation and the attachment of the tail with respect to the fuselage, everything plays a role. And that is why here also with the Mach number, if it is an elastic analysis to a rigid analysis as a ratio, you see it starts decreasing the effectiveness of the elevator, any control surface, okay, with speed. These are all within the flight envelope. Please understand, not that they are beyond the flight envelope. Okay. So these problems have to be tackled when you are doing an aeroelastic analysis. Okay. And okay, this is something which I thought you all know. Plan form, does it affect the my aeroelastic thing? Plan form in the sense, wings sweep. Yes, it has an effect on divergence. Okay. Usually if you sweep the wing back, the divergence speed is good. But aileron decreases. But if you sweep forward, divergence speed really decreases. Only one aircraft, test aircraft. That's why you don't find any aircraft flying with the forward sweep. This is just to show you there is one test aircraft. This is X-29 Grumman, the 1984, they flew this. Because this is with the aeroelastic tailoring of composite material. Composite material was used. Okay, this was a test aircraft. And so you have seen the distribution, these problems. How these were really 1926 was the first, I'll write that, who, you know, the credit has to be given to the people who contributed. 1926, Hans Reisner. Okay. He presented wing load distribution. Okay. Wing load distribution. Distribution and wing divergence. And then, of course, 1932, Roxby, Cox and Pugsley gave theory of loss of lateral control. And in 1935, we have the potential flow flutter. Was understood, potential flow. Okay, but actually it is very interesting. At that time, these are mathematicians and designers. were reluctant to believe the theoreticians, particularly in all these areas. But now, what in that in aeroelastic? Okay, you know the problem. Today, the field of aeroelasticity is, what is that we are doing is, for every aircraft you have to analyze it, number one. And number two is, you are using composite materials, different structural forms of design. Therefore, the aeroelastic problems assume greater significance, particularly if the aircraft is highly flexible like that, you need to have to analyze this type of problem. Now I will also go a little away from the only aircraft. Is the only aircraft aeroelastic problems are necessary? That may be one question which may arise. But actually, aeroelastic problems are important in several areas, and those are, I'll just list them out for your basic understanding, but we will not be covering those things. Okay. That is, you can have in gas turbines, okay. Okay. Then, of course, rotary wing or helicopters. These are related to, and then you can have bridge, then you can have transmission lines, okay, and ship and offshore structure. Okay, and maybe tall buildings, and even biological things. Biological here, basically blood flow through various blood vessels, okay. So biological application, all these are related to the broad field of fluid structure interaction, okay. But we call it aeroelasticity when we say we focus on problems related to this. Any flying vehicle. Flying vehicle, we are not bothered about these things, but they also are related to aeroelastic problems. We may call it fluid structure interaction problem, okay. But we restrict ourselves, but here again, I would like to say, aeroelastic problems are very peculiar for the type of aircraft. If you deal with the gas turbine, that is a specialization. If you deal with helicopters, that is another specialization. If you deal with fixed wing, this is another specialization. So it is not that one person can handle everything, because it depends on what is his research interest and how he continues his field. But in this course, what we will cover is fixed wing. Because why they are different is, essentially the flow is different. In the case of gas turbines, you have stator, rotor, everything is there. And the flow goes through that, axial flow, but then the situation is different. In the case of wing, it's a different flow pattern. And you have subsonic, transonic, supersonic, all types of designs. In the case of helicopters, then it is a rotating beam, and it has its own peculiarities of the flow pattern. That is why the problems are also of different type. All are aeroelasticity. Okay. So it is very essential to understand which field you are focusing on, and then you are pursuing that area. You may not find the similar type of problems what I listed out here in helicopters. Okay, similar, but they have their own aeroelastic problem. Okay, so in this course we will cover only the problems related to fixed wing type, and I thought I'll show a few video and also some of the reference material. So first we will go to the reference material which you require. Okay, these are, I have listed out the various references. Actually Scanlan, Rosen, these are all old books, 1951, Fung again 55. That third book, Bishplinghoff, Ashley and Hoffman, Aeroelasticity, that is a, it's a very good book, there in the library. And of course, I think it is not in print now. And the fourth one is a modern course, and they have a lot of prints. This book is also good, fourth one. Fifth is, some sections are handled. And of course, this is the latest book, Hodges and Pierce, which is the introduction to structural dynamics and aeroelasticity. And I also have short course notes, which was given by Indo-US, under Indo-US Science Technology, Computational Methods in Aeroelasticity. Okay, but this is not available. I thought I refer it. If you want to have a look at it, you can always have a look at it. And then, of course, research publication. Okay, so these are our reference books. But I will cover the syllabus in the, pretty much I follow 3 and 4. Okay. Now, I listed out the various speeds, which is just for indication. Very, you know, it is only some kind of pictorial representation. How the critical speeds, because we said there is a divergence, there is a control reversal or aileron reversal, and then there is a flutter. Okay. Now, how they vary with the sweep of the wing. Okay. If you see sweep back, that is what you see normally in all the aircraft, divergence speed is high. Flutter speed is here, but aileron reversal is low. So, aileron reversal becomes critical. Of course, all are critical, I am just saying. Whereas, when you go to the sweep forward, aileron reversal is fine, but divergence is critical. And flutter speed is almost like this with the sweep. But the divergence is a major problem, that is why you don't find swept forward aircraft. Okay, except for that experimental one X-29, which was, I just wanted to show that this is existing. Okay, now I will show some videos of actually the dynamic aeroelasticity, because under dynamic aeroelasticity, we had three. One is flutter, another one buffeting, and then third one dynamic load. Now, what are these problems? Okay. I just want to show some of the civil thing. First, I thought I will, I hope it will, yeah, place. See, this is the galloping of the transmission lines. Okay. I don't know whether you are able to see, this is the transmission line which is vibrating in a crosswind, and they will snap. Okay, yeah. Just to show how they vibrate the transmission lines. even though this is an aeroelastic problem, we are not going to deal with that. This is for you to know that, well, these things happen, okay. And then the Boeing 747, all our video, this is, okay, then another civil structure I will show. This is about the bridge. This is always shown as the Tacoma Narrows. Whenever they want to say any, you know, aeroelastic problem, this bridge opened and within a short time it collapsed, because one day wind started and then I think 1942 or something like that, okay. But for the wing, I will show a few of the videos. This is how the, see, is in a wind tunnel thing, how the wing starts vibrating. And you don't do anything, it is just the natural flow that makes this. And similarly here, there is a tail part, tail stabilizer, okay. This is also in a wind tunnel. Okay. And this is another one which we have mounted. We created a small flutter model, you see, because we had to cut it. You see the kind of vibration it happens. It's an aerofoil supported on four, actually this is a spring mechanism. We mounted it and then we allowed it to in the low speed tunnel, and you see at a particular speed it starts. Really very violent oscillation it has. I don't know whether it is clear or not. And this is another one which I thought I will show you. This is a tail. See? Tail and control surface. Okay. So these are actually the real issues which one has to analyze it. Now the question is, how do we analyze, what do we do? Okay. That is what the entire course is about. We will develop the background material, how do we formulate the equation of motion, and then what is the method of solution, and how do we predict various phenomena. And that is what we will cover in this course. Now I would like to go a little into, just as an introduction, today the flutter, what is flutter, what is buffet, dynamic response. Flutter, normally we refer any two or more degrees of freedom of the structure, case of wing, two or more degrees, please note that. When they combine, couple, and then get into some kind of a oscillation, usually this is called a classical flutter, okay. I will put it classical, within bracket I will write bending, torsion, flutter. That means the bending motion and the torsion motion, they couple to create a instability. Okay, that is what you saw that video when it really went into violent oscillation. Because violent oscillation, normally the structure will break. But is that all you have? Only this type of flutter you have. See, there can be even a single degree of freedom flutter, which can be there. Single degree means only torsion. That's why in turbine blades, the torsion flutter becomes, because it is almost rigid, you will have a torsion flutter type of problem. That's a single degree of freedom flutter can happen in turbine blade. That is why I said it's not the same problem everywhere. Another aspect is non-classical, because we say classical, non-classical. That means you can have, this is a classical when I mention it is under attached flow condition. You can take it as attached flow condition. Attached flow over the aerofoil, no problem. But suppose you have attached, detached, attached, detached, then it is like a stall is inducing a vibration. So you can have stall flutter, okay. In this situation, what happened? Your aerofoil will be at one point flow is going like this, and in the other point flow is separating it out, and again it comes attaches. Okay, this is different kind of a problem, because you need to know the detached flow also, stall characteristic, how the pressure varies, everything, and that comes under stall flutter kind of problem. Now people also talk about, this is not part of this, they call it LCO, limit cycle oscillation, okay. Now what is the limit cycle oscillation? See, here if you go beyond some speed, that flutter speed, it's going to violently. Whereas in this, what happens is after something, it continues to vibrate. There is a continuous vibration happening. It is not a diverging vibration. Now, here, usually nonlinear systems can exhibit this type of, because nonlinearity is, you may have to come with the nonlinear. This is analyzed with the linear system, you can solve, because our potential flow is a linear theory. So we are doing that linear theory, whereas here stall flutter is not a linear theory anymore, because you have attachment, detachment, everything is happening. And here that limit cycle can be nonlinear. It could be structural nonlinearity, it could be aerodynamic nonlinearity. You follow? So these are the types of flutter problems. So in this we deal with bending torsion flutter. Okay. But in the case of helicopters, they are of a different type. You also have stall problem, but not flutter. We don't call it flutter, because we have the helicopter blade, it will bend up out of plane, it will also bend in plane. So you have a flap lag instability, whereas there is no lag motion in the case of an aircraft wing. You have only bending and torsion, whereas in helicopter blades you have a out of plane bending, in plane bending, torsion, everything. The out of plane and in plane themselves can couple to give you flap lag instability. That is why I said each flying vehicle has its own special characteristic problems. Okay. And then the buffeting part. Okay. This is usually happens. The disturbance in the flow causes the vibration. Okay, that is, suppose if you are having a high CL max pull up of the aircraft, the wing, because there is a change in the loading, everything on the wing, and that creates a vortex behind it. That disturbance goes and affects the tail, and the tail starts vibrating. Under that circumstance, this is a little different. The disturbance of the flow is creating the vibration. Now you say, what is the difference between this bending and that problem? Here, please note, it is one aerofoil. That's all. The flow is, please understand, it is steady. Flow is steady, this is there, but it is flexible to oscillate. Now, when this oscillates in a steady flow, okay, it creates a lot of disturbance behind. Okay. Usually, this type of problem is the, this is the classical flutter. This we don't call it buffeting. Buffeting is when the flow itself is unsteady flow because it is due to some other structure in front, and that is that time variation of the flow is affecting my tail vibration. Now, only way to avoid that particular problem is you position your tail suitably, because that is more complicated problem, because you don't know how the flow gets disturbed because of a high CL. Okay. So, the positioning of the tail plays a major role there. And of course, the last one is the dynamic response. Dynamic response is when the aircraft is landing, the landing loads immediately, it is an impulse type of loading, very short duration but heavy load, and that will make the wing vibrate. Okay. That is the dynamic response of the aircraft under landing situations, or even gust response. Again, the atmospheric gust, gust is always represented by some mathematical representation, because it is a statistically collected, and then they represent like a 1 minus cosine or a step gust, and see if it comes and hits, how the aircraft will vibrate. Okay. This is what they normally treat in the dynamic aeroelastic problem, but for our case, we will be studying the flutter problem under dynamic aeroelastic condition. So, the entire course, now I will given you a background of the history and some of these what are the aeroelastic problems which you encounter. Because what we do first is the structural analysis we will introduce. How do you model the wing? Because we will restrict the whole study to wing. Okay. And 2D aerofoils. This is what we are restricting our study to. So, all the things related to that, we will first modeling of a aircraft wing for bending torsion, because even though you have done the structures one course, it is very important that those details are required. Why? Because in a, what is that you have learnt in an aerofoil, what are the various points, important points? 5 minutes. Okay, what are the important points are? One is aerodynamic center, which you may say 25% card for, I'll call it AC, subsonic 25%, subsonic, supersonic it will be half, we'll take 25% card. Okay. And structures, you take elastic or shear center or elastic. So, I will mark that elastic axis or shear center. Okay. And then inertia, you can have mass center. Okay. I think now we can cut. Aerodynamic center, mass center, elastic axis. Now, mass center goes towards your structural design, what material you have used, how, where you put the stiffeners, etcetera, etcetera. Aerodynamic center is purely shape, that's all, nothing else. Whereas, elastic axis or the shear center, that again depends on your structural details. Okay. So now, if you are given an aerofoil section, you have to know all these points. Why it is critical? If you take the static aeroelastic problem first, you know that your lift is going to integrated value, lift and moment acts at the aerodynamic center, the resultant of the lift. Now the wing will twist about elastic axis, not mass center. That is a dynamic case, static case, elastic axis. Now you see it will start twisting. So all these centers become very critical. Okay, so modeling, first learn how do you model the structure. So I would say you better learn how to get the elastic axis or the shear center of a box beam, thin walled structure, which was taught in your structures course, but you must know that. Because if I give you one problem where find out that, you have to go and then calculate and find the location of the shear center and then calculate the divergence speed means, you must know all these things. Okay. And then the distribution of mass. So these are critical. Now in this course I will not be going into everything, all these things, because I presume that you know it. But potential flow I will introduce, because unsteady aerodynamic theory is not taught in the regular course. So I will introduce the unsteady aerodynamic theory. Also, how do you model a flexible wing in an approximate manner? And then how do you solve this problem? That is what we will be studying in this course. From next class we will start that. Okay.